Hey guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and today I want to talk about the importance and some of the obstacles to capturing a medieval aesthetic as part of medieval recreation. Now, within living history and reenactment, or even as modern artists and game designers, a lot of us have the self-stated goal of making something as historically accurate as possible, as if it was plucked directly from the time period that we're trying to evoke. Now, a lot of designs can approximate that feeling or give a superficial impression of a medieval object, especially dependent on your target audience. But to really nail it, one of the most important yet most elusive things can be trying to capture the unique aesthetic of the time. So what is an aesthetic? Now, at its most fundamental, an aesthetic is what looks good, what looks beautiful visually and stylistically to a people in a given time period. Through it, we can observe their mindset, their worldview, the themes that they found culturally important. More pragmatically, we can observe the techniques that they used, their specific approaches to design and problem solving, and how all these things culminate into what they found attractive. We will see this reflected in their artwork, in their clothing, in their armor, in their equipment, in their music, in their material culture. And it is these sometimes elusive elements that we are trying to bring to life through the medium of educational living history. A person familiar with a given time period should immediately be able to recognize an object as belonging to that time, and for that to happen, it must carry the right aesthetic. Now, as modern people, one of the biggest obstacles that we face when trying to reproduce the visual appeal of the past is that we have a tendency to project our own modern aesthetic and our own modern biases onto historical objects. So firstly, we need to be aware that this bias occurs if we want to have any chance of trying to reduce it. We have our own societal and cultural ideas of what looks good to us, what we find attractive, certain color combinations, certain visual styles, the machine precision of a modern age, what we think looks cool, what we think looks tough. And if we can't recognize that we're doing this, and then if we can't let go of that, what inevitably happens is it leads to a reproduction that may resemble a historical object in name and function, but instead carries a very modern feel and look to it. If our goal is to produce something truly historical, and I recognize that that's not everyone's goal, we do not have unlimited creative freedom. Instead, we are bound by a certain set of aesthetic parameters that we should strive to work within. We must try to view medieval objects through the eyes of a medieval person with their own sense of what looks good. We must try to see the world as they saw it. We must learn to love the sources. Even within the Middle Ages, which span close to 1,000 years, aesthetics shift over time and differ from one region to another, and all of these contextual differences should be taken into account for our purposes. For example, the crucifixion of Christ is a ubiquitous artistic theme depicted in various ways throughout the medieval period. Now, if I, as a modern person, wanted to create a piece of artwork that captured that medieval aesthetic, in other words, it felt like a genuinely medieval piece of artwork of the image of Christ on the cross, there are certain stylistic and technical cues that I have to pay attention to. As we travel through time and we look at different examples, we can see how this common image changes over the centuries. How realistic or how simplistic are the individual figures drawn? What proportions are emphasized? How do they draw faces? What are the people wearing? How is dimensional perspective handled? What elements are emphasized? What mediums are common? Tempera paints? Oil paints? Is the use of metallic embellishment or leafing common? Each of these factors affects the final visual result and contributes to that overall aesthetic. So if I want to reproduce an image of the crucifixion in the mid-14th century Italian style, I need to capture those representative elements that were most commonly used in mid-14th century Italian artwork. Simply selecting individual characteristics from a combination of the previous example images and throwing them all into one composition, or even worse, painting a modern photorealistic image of Christ on the cross and simply donning all of my foreground figures in 14th century armor would both be disingenuous approaches to trying to capture an authentic medieval aesthetic. Now, I picked that example because I think it's easy to visualize why those two approaches might be incorrect. But as reenactors, we have a tendency to take those exact liberties with a lot of the other material culture that we try to reproduce. Now, if that level of authenticity or historical accuracy accuracy is not important to the activity that you do, more power to you, do what you do. But many of us state that that is our goal and then do those things anyway, which I think is a little bit counterproductive. A lot of us use leather goods in our recreations, from cases to shoes to scabbards for daggers and swords, and we know that real historical leather work was often highly decorated depending on the status of the individual who owned it. Now, this does not mean that we should just cover all of our leather work in any design or motif that we modernly associate with the medieval period and call it good. When we observe decorative leather work from the Middle Ages, we observe certain specific techniques and specific design motifs that come up time and time again, and these should inform our creative choices. It's not just the decorative elements either, but also the way these objects are constructed, if they're of multi-layer construction, what kind of stitches were used, the way that they're shaped. All of these things are necessary for a complete impression, and it's these details that breathe authenticity into an object. Now, this primarily being a channel about medieval armor, we can see how aesthetics apply in that arena as well. When we look at historical armor, we have to observe the details and the commonalities between objects, the subtlety of shaping in individual plates, the way the medieval mind engineered a functional visor, the ways that the breadths are pierced and laid out, the common dimensions and shapes of the sights, and of course, just like with the previous examples, the decoration on armor is important too. If our goal is to create something as authentic as possible, it is not enough to just embellish our armor with medievalish decoration. We should observe the commonly used decorative motifs found within the context of the armor whose aesthetic we are trying to replicate. This is why it's not enough to just create something that looks cool and, because we have a desire to call it historical, hide behind the argument that, well, you don't know that they didn't do this. If we're trying to recreate something as historical as possible, and I recognize that that is not everyone's goal, we can't be concerned with what we don't know they didn't do. It doesn't really make any sense. We need to be concerned with what we do know they did. And if the object in question ignores a well-defined medieval aesthetic, born of a large body of evidence and surviving historical objects that all bear certain aesthetic consistencies and approaches to problem solving and to design problems, we can say with a reasonable amount of certainty that the object in question does not appear historical. For example, I think we could all agree that if we were trying to produce a historical reproduction of a bassinet with Kerberg 13 as our inspiration, if on the brass band around the visor we chose a modern Times New Roman font and engraved in modern English a quote from Shakespeare's Henry V, that even though the idea behind it is about the Middle Ages, the result would be jarringly modern in aesthetic and in execution. Now, for the same reasons, it would be equally, if not more, jarringly modern in appearance if on the same bassinet we invented an entirely new shape of ocular or got overly creative with the layout of the breadths in a way that doesn't appear consistent with any known historical objects. To do so is to project our modern aesthetic onto a historical helmet. So how do we let go of our modern aesthetic? Now, like I've said earlier, we need to recognize that we have this tendency, and also recognize that, you know, it's not possible to eliminate it entirely. We can't eliminate all of our cognitive biases, but we need to recognize that it's happening so that we can at least try. And the best way to do this is to learn to love the sources. Stop looking at modern reproductions. One of the most harmful things we can do to ourselves, especially in the early stages, is to spend all of our time looking at other reenactors and, by extension, looking primarily at modern reproductions. Now, modern reproductions can be very useful. I use them all the time on my channel as a teaching tool, but they cannot be our primary window into the past because we'd only be looking at the present. What this threatens to do is actually program our brain to develop an aesthetic preference for modern reproductions. Some modern armor has its own very distinct styling because it appeals to the modern eye, and because of that it becomes popular, it gets copied a lot, and if we spend all of our time looking at these objects in the absence of the historical objects, what we're doing is training our eye to expect to see the design cues uniquely associated with those modern armors, not what the real objects looked like. So how do we combat this? Well, stop primarily looking at modern reproductions and start trying to immerse yourself in the time period that you want to replicate. Absorb the artwork. Absorb the surviving material culture. Spend time in 14th century England. Spend time in the Low Countries, the 15th century. Go to a museum if you're lucky enough to live close to one. If not, almost all of the major collections are published online now with incredible photography of a lot of the surviving objects. Compare those objects to the artwork. Look at them critically. Look at the shapes. Look at the details. Look for the commonalities between objects. If you like to draw, practice drawing these objects in critical detail. Learn to love the sources. It's not something that can be rushed. It's not something that you can pick up overnight. It will demand patience and a lot of intensive study. It's a skill to be developed over a lifelong passion for history, and it yields tremendous rewards, but we can really delay that development if we're not careful with how we spend our energy now. Learn to love the sources. Now, I understand that simply not everyone wants to or has the goal to do things to that level of accuracy. Not everyone cares, who watches this channel, cares about doing educational strict living history, but having that foundational understanding of the real objects can really inform us, inform the creative choices that we make in whatever activity it is that we do, from strict living history to other forms of reenactment, to modern combat sports, to the SCA, even to fantasy role-playing and world building and game design. It enables us to understand the why behind our creative choices and understand the ways that we may be departing from the real thing. And hopefully we can recognize that in order to develop that understanding, we have to try to make an attempt to look at objects as they did, not necessarily how we want them to look. So guys, thanks for watching the video. I hope it's given you something to think about. Recognize that we're all guilty of this. Everybody does this. Everybody will look at the past through their own lens, but we need to strive to separate ourselves from our own personal preferences if that goal is to reproduce things as they were. Guys, thanks for watching. If you liked the video, please leave me a thumbs up. If you have any questions or comments, please leave those down below. Special thanks to my patrons on Patreon who make the channel possible in the first place. And we'll catch you guys in the next video. Thanks for watching. Bye.